unless we've learned how to be overcomers, we're going to be like clay in the hands of the enemy. We can be overcomers. We can experience victory. We can experience the power made possible through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And God's word shows us how.
Whether it's a heat crisis, severe cold spell, or a person without a home, New Life Evangelistic Center is engaged in helping the hurting in mid-America. Around the clock, the staff labor to help those who are facing hopeless situations. In order to be able to reach out in this way, the NLEC staff find singing, praying, and worshiping God together to be essential in their labor of love. We invite you now to join Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of New Life Evangelistic Center as they worship together with the fatherless, widowed, and homeless. Let the same Holy Spirit who strengthens them daily minister to you as you join them in renewing your commitment to serve our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and reaching out to the world around us.
God is calling all of us at this particular time to be overcomers, who through the resurrection power of Jesus Christ are victorious over sin, death, and the devil. Let's go to the Lord right now in prayer. Father God, I'm asking you right now in the name of Jesus to pour your Holy Spirit down upon us, Lord. Lord, there's so many broken, crushed lives within the sound of my voice. So many people feeling hopeless, Lord, and totally helpless. I'm asking you now to open our eyes, Lord, to show us how we can be overcomers over the evil one. How we can be victorious, Lord. We're looking to you. We're standing on the promises of your word. We're standing in the assurance, Lord Jesus, that greater is he, you, who's in us than he that's in the world. Come now, Lord Jesus, and minister to us. We ask in your name we pray. Amen. Revelations chapter 2, verse 7 says, to him, and includes her, who overcomes, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is the paradise of God. There's a promise. To the one that overcomes, he says, I give the right to eat from the tree of life. And God's word shows us how we can be overcomers at this particular time. How hard it is to be an overcomer when one's persecuted and put in prison and suffering and need. We're told in Revelation chapter 2, verse 10, do not be afraid about what you're to suffer. I tell you, the devil's going to put some in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days, but be faithful even to the point of death. And here's the promise, I will give you the crown of life. That's what I want. How about you? I want to know what God's word has to say about this. I'm sick and tired of Satan pushing me around, aren't you? Aren't you getting tired? Isn't it time to just stomp the devil and say, I'm fed up with you, Satan? I want what Jesus has for me at this particular hour, where the pressure's on and we can't afford to give up. As Satan attacks, we've got to learn to resist him steadfastly in the faith. Because as we read here in James chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Perseverance must finish its works that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Some of you are going through it right now. Don't give up. Give it to God. Use the sword of the Spirit and the shield to quench every fiery dart of the evil one. You can read all about that in Revelation chapter 6, verse 16 and 17. Remember, Satan has been defeated through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen? He's been defeated. Yes, the Bible says the devil walks around like a roaring lion seeking to devour, but he's a toothless lion. Because of Jesus and the power of the resurrection, his teeth have been pulled out. Now, if you let him, he'll gnaw on you, and he'll roar at you. But you need to be able to stomp your feet and say, I'm a child of God, and Satan, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I want to live in the light of what God's word has to say. And this is what Jesus has done in Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 through 15. God made you alive with Christ. That's who you are. You need to start seeing yourself that way. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the written code with his regulations that was against us and that stood opposed to us. He took it away, nailing it to the cross, and having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle over them, triumphing over them by the cross. Thank you, Jesus. Amen? Then why are you living like you're so defeated? My brothers and sisters, times are getting hard. You better know what God's word has to say. You better get into God's word here. You pick up a newspaper. Listen to the news. You know, it can get downright disheartening. Terrorist attacks over here, and kids dying over here, and cholera epidemic spreading, and earthquakes, and wars, rumors of wars, volcanoes, hurricanes, tornadoes, all of it coming out. We say, what in the world is going on? And all the crime, corruption, and murders. It almost appears that we're reading straight from Revelation chapter 12, verse 12, where it says, woe to the earth and the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He's filled with fury because he knows that his time is short. Some of you have encountered that fury of Satan, haven't you? You've just seen it cut loose. People you trusted, people you love, you know, suddenly turn on you. And just like the devil just came right over them. What do you do at such a time like this? And this fury is further described as you continue to read in the book of Revelations when Satan teams up with the beast. And you see all that there in Revelations chapter 13, verse 6 through 10. Let me read a little bit to you. He opened his mouth to blaspheme God and to slander his name and his dwelling place and those who live in heaven. He was given power to make war against the saints and to conquer them. And he was given authority over every tribe, people, language, and nation. All inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast, all whose names have not been written in the book of life, belonging to the Lamb that was slain from the creation of the world. He who has an ear, let him hear. If anyone is to go into captivity, into captivity you go. If anyone is to be killed with the sword to be killed. What do we need? This calls for patience, endurance, and faithfulness on the part of the saints. How do we have that kind of patience, endurance, and faithfulness? So many given to sin at times like that. Some of you, if you've gone through some really tough times, you've done that. You've given in. You've been there. You've done that. What's it done for you? We need to do it different this time. We need to know what God's Word has to say. We need to be able to stand on the promises of God's Word, remain steadfast, immovable, abounding in the work of the Lord, even when the fury of the enemy is cut loose, because we can overcome the evil one. God has called us to be more than conquerors, not just survivors, but more than conquerors through Christ Jesus who strengthens us. You see that in Romans chapter 8. When you get over to Ephesians 6, verses 10 through 12, we're told to be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you'll take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers of the dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realm. And you go to Ephesians 6, you'll see what that full armor is. You'll see the helmet of salvation, the assurance, through your mind. You've got that helmet of salvation there to protect it. So that mind's a gateway kind of like to the soul. The enemy attacked you with all kinds of things. It tells you to put up the shield of faith and resist the fiery darts of the evil one. Put on the belt of truth. Jesus, he's the way, the truth, and the light. Shoe your feet with the gospel of peace, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Put on the breastplate of righteousness. And the shoes, the gospel of peace, the breastplate of righteousness, the full armor of God described in Ephesians chapter 6. Well, the fact is you and I are involved in a spiritual battle in which we're called to be victors and not victims. Some of you see yourself as victims right now. Oh, you don't know what happened to me. I had this happen. I had that. It's easy for us to fall in that victim mentality. I want you to start changing your thinking right now. And can you say this? I am a victor. I'm a victor. Not a victim. I'm a victor. Not a victim. I'm a winner. Not a whiner. All right. You got that? All right. Let's get back into God's Word right here and see what it tells us. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, 18, 19, we're told to fight the good fight, holding on to the faith and a good conscience. Fight the good fight, holding on to the faith. You can't fight the good fight. If you're double-minded, you believe one day, you don't believe the next day, back and forth, hold on to the faith. And to the faith and a good conscience. You can't have a good conscience. You're sinning on one side here and there every time you get a chance. No, good conscience. Getting into words God's Word. Living the way he wants you to do. It says, some have rejected these and so have shipwrecked their faith. They've totally shipwrecked their faith because they rejected this. They rejected the faith, the good conscience, didn't hold on to faith, they shipwrecked it. You know, fighting the good fight is as the Lord told Zerubbabel in Zechariah 4:6. He said, it's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. Some of you feel totally powerless. Some of you feel like you don't have enough might and strength to go on. Remember this word. Memorize some of these Bible verses. Not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. Lord, this is a real 911 prayer, dear God. This is more than I got strength and might for, but I need your Holy Spirit right now, Jesus. Pour your Holy Spirit down on me and strengthen me and help me to be an overcomer. I'm going to believe you at this time. I'm tired of the devil telling me that I'm going to fail at this because I failed everything else in life. He's a liar, isn't he? He's the father of lies. This is the first day of the rest of your life. Take up that shield of faith. Take up that sharp two-edged sword of the Word of God and move forward. You know, I found in my daily battles that these words are so true that it's not by might nor power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. Satan, he tries to defeat me with depression, anxiety, frustration, and times even hopelessness. And even sometimes people that you're close to or work to, they're having a tough time, and they can take it out on you. But I got to stay in the road of the Lord, right? You got to pray for him. Amen? I remember that victory is not through my own power or might, but by the Spirit of God. And this is further illustrated in Revelation chapter 12, verse 10 and 11, where it says, now has come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before our God day and night has been hurled down. They overcame him through the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. We're victorious over Satan because of the blood of the Lamb. Now you think back to the Old Testament, go back to the book of Exodus and Exodus chapter 12, 13, when the angel of death was coming over, they had to take a little lamb, sacrificed it, and they put the blood at the doorpost, and the angel of death passed over, okay? Now, we got to put that at the doorpost of our life. How do we do that? By accepting Jesus as our Lord and Savior, and our testimony by the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony applies at the doorpost of our life, the angel of death has to pass right on over. And that destructive plague can't touch us. Well, you see, as Satan attacks us day and night, you and I got to learn to resist him. He's going to try to make us feel like the situation's hopeless, and he's going to try to tell us things will never change. That's why every moment we got to submit ourselves to God and experience his hope as we resist the devil and his hopelessness. Listen to James chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. Submit yourself then to God, resist the devil. What does it say? So look at what it's telling you. It's got some very practical advice here. Down-to-earth stuff. Who says the Bible doesn't apply to us today? They're ridiculous. They never read the Bible. It's very practical. Right here it says, submit yourself. Okay, surrender, Lord, I surrender to you, my problems, my needs, all these things right now. I'm submitting myself to you, to God. Submit yourself then to God. Resist the devil. Satan, I'm telling you, be gone. I'm going to follow Jesus Christ. I'm going to trust the truth of his word and not the lies you put in my brain. I'm going to trust the word of the Lord. Resist the devil. And what happens when you resist him? The Bible says he's going to flee from you. So you can pray, Lord, I'm coming to you right now in the name of Jesus. I'm resisting the devil. And according to your word, he's got to flee. And you got to take off. All right. It says, come near to God. Come near to God. Lord, I want to come near to you. You open your eyes. You see all the wonderful things that he's created. You get into the word of God. Draw close to God. You're hungering and thirsty after God for more than anything else. It says, come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands. How do you do this? Through the grace and blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, I come before you right now. He says, wash your hands. I want to repent, Lord. You sinners, purify your heart. You're double-minded, okay? Now, this washing and purifying is done by believing the fact that the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, purifies from all sin. 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. Very practical advice, things to do to conquer the evil one. Now, when Satan tries to tempt us, we got to do what Jesus did when he was tempted. You see, Jesus was tempted. Go to Matthew chapter 4, and you're going to see that. And Satan would always take the scriptures out of context, and a lot of things, people take scripture out of context and all. The devil did the same thing to Jesus, but Jesus knew the word, and he came right back on him. And right now, when the devil said, well, worship me, bow down before me, and serve me, and I'll give you all this. You don't have to go through the pain of the cross. Jesus responds in Matthew chapter 4, verse 10, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. And then we see after Jesus spoke to Satan that way, in Matthew chapter 4, verse 11, the devil left him and the angels came down and attended to him. Now, you may think you're going through it right now. Nobody's got the troubles I got. And that may be the song you've been singing. Well, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13 tells you otherwise. It says, no temptation has seized you, no temptation has come to you, no temptation has grabbed a hold of you, except what is common to men and women, okay? And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted more beyond what you can bear. And when you're tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. You hear that? God is faithful. Ain't? Y'all awake? Listening to this? Come on, you need to know how to get equipped. Because, I mean, he's cutting loose out there, isn't he? I'm telling you, it's happening. It's happening. We need to know it because Satan wants to destroy you. 1 Timothy chapter 5, 8 warns you, and it tells you here, be self-controlled and alert. It's easy to lose control today, isn't it? Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. I quoted that to you earlier from 1 Peter 5, 8, but I told you his teeth already been taken out. Jesus is Lord. You're walking around seeking to devour, but he's not going to devour you. You're standing in the word of the Lord, unless you're going to sit there and be a whiner instead of a winner and see yourself as a victim rather than a victor and just let him gnaw on you all day. He'll sooner or later swallow you. Come on, you don't want to live that way, do you? Been there, done that. The Lord is raising up people right now that he's putting his word in. He wants you and I to do that. He wants to. I remember one time, some 38 years ago, we had an old mansion over on Park Avenue. It was over 110 years old. And one night, I was talking to one of the staff, and we were praising God over all the things that God was doing. And suddenly, here we were on the second floor. Nobody's around. We heard this voice said, "Did he?" And the other guy started saying, "Yes, Lord, speak." I said, "That wasn't God. He doesn't question himself. In the name of Jesus, we bound him up and cast him out." Yeah, Satan, he tries to say different things. But you know, we can stand on the Word of God. I've encountered on numerous occasions people who have let Satan get a toehold in their life. That's what he'll do. He'll get a little toehold. Then he got a foothold, and then he establishes a stronghold. Now, maybe he's got a toehold in your life right now. Maybe he's got a foothold in your life right now. But, you know, you need to get rid of him. Maybe he's even got a stronghold in your life right now. Well, we got to resist Satan, okay? Now, in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, 3 and 4, it says this, "For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds." So through the blood of Jesus Christ, which cleanses from all sin, the Word of God, the power of the Holy Spirit at work, those strongholds can be pulled down and destroyed. Now, that stronghold may have got in there years ago. Somebody really hurt you, maybe as a child, maybe as a teenager, maybe as a previous relationship or something. You really got hurt, and there's just a stronghold in there. Somebody says something to you, somebody does something, and you're just ready to get them. What do? You got to let the Word of God take work, go back in the past, heal that hurt, see that you're a new creation in Christ, see that that's the past, and that this is a new day, and God's doing a new work. Remember what 1 John chapter 5, verse 4 and 5 says, "For everyone born of God overcomes the world." Everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that's overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Who is it that overcomes the world? How do you overcome the world? Only he or she who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. That's how you overcome the world. And don't just believe it in your head. It's become a part of your life down deep within your heart. That when the world is crumbling, that Satan is cast to earth and he knows his time is short and he's gauging in all his furious and crazy activity, you can say, "I know that Jesus Christ is Lord, and I know that it's going to get wilder and crazier right before he comes back, but he's going to come back, praise God, and he's going to establish his kingdom. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. God is good." Promise after promise is given to the overcomer in Revelation chapter 2 and 3. And in spite of these words of promise, it's easy to get tired out, worn out, and burned out as we battle the devil, the world, and our flesh daily. He just wants to keep leaning on you. That's why you're told in Scripture, remain steadfast, immovable, abounding in the work and the will of God. And that's why it's so critical you keep your daily appointments with God. If you are too busy to spend time with the Lord today, you are too busy engaged in all kinds of frivolous stuff that just didn't get anything or do anything for you. Those daily appointments with God. In those appointments, we talk to God in prayer, we read the Scriptures, and meditate on His Word, His power, and the wonder of His creation. We see it all around us. We see God. He's so good. Spend time reflecting on the goodness and grace of God. I want to tell you something. You know, as you walk through life in your journey, if God brings you to it, He's going to bring you through it. Do you know that? As you've surrendered your life to the Lord, you have those appointments with God, you're trusting God, and you're encountering something, and you're following the Lord, if God brings you to it, He's going to bring you through it. Do you realize that? So you need to start trusting Him. After all, He's told you in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 12, "For the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, those who are upright and in right standing with God, and His ears are attentive, open to their prayer." And as we read and meditate on the Scriptures, we must never forget that God watches over His Word to perform it. Do you see that? Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 12. God watches over His Word to perform it. Prayer that brings results must be anchored in the Word of God. And we see in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 this, "For the Word that God speaks is alive and full of power. It's active, operative, energizing, and effective. It's sharper than any two-edged sword, penetrating to the dividing line of the breath of life, the soul, and the immortal spirit, and of the joints and marrow, that's the deepest part of our nature, exposing and sifting and analyzing and judging the very thoughts and purposes of the heart." Instead of just giving up when we feel overwhelming physical, mental, and spiritual needs, we need to know and pray the Scriptures, which declare, as Philippians 4:19 says, "And my God will meet all your needs," not some of your needs, all your needs, "according to His glorious riches in Christ Jesus." We're just sharing with you the Word of the Lord here. I'm not giving you my opinion on things. I'm not telling you jokes and all this other stuff. I'm just trying to give you the Word of God. You know what I mean? And as you get into the Word of God, and you just start seeing that He's going to meet all your needs, along with great blessings come great responsibilities. Along with great blessings come great responsibilities. And some get tired of those responsibilities, you know, and some of you maybe even feel tempted to give up in the midst of them. I think all of us have had times like that, but I want to tell you something. Thank God for the encouraging words spoken by the Lord. through my fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. I thank the Lord for that. When David found himself in a real fix in Ziklag, his kids had been taken from him, his wives had been taken from him, everything had been taken from him, and the men were about ready to stone him. In 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 6, we see David encouraged himself in the Lord. He encouraged the rest of his men, and they went on to be victorious. They went and took back all that had been taken from them. In Revelations 2:17, we read, "He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him or her who overcomes, I will give some of the hidden manna. I will also give him a white stone with a new name written on it, known only to him or her who receives it." Revelations 2:17. Now the hour has come for us to be overcomers. And that means moving deeper into the things of God as we receive the hidden manna of God's spiritual truth and the bread of life that Jesus Christ provides in a new and powerful way. Now, as we begin to do that and get into the Word of God, then we're going to realize what it is to possess the white stone with a new name written on it, signifying what it is to be an overcomer who through life lives a victorious life day after day. God wants to do a new work within your life. He's desiring to do a new work within your life. You need it right now. Some of you have been given in and being destroyed and crushed and oppressed by the enemy day after day after day. This is the first day of the rest of your life. Start living victoriously. Start getting into what God's Word has to say. We're supposed to be doers of the Word, not just hearers only. Some accumulate all kinds of Bible knowledge. To him or her, much is given, much is required. I mean, we got to act on that. James chapter 1, verse 22, it says, not only be hearers of the Word, but be doers also. And people who are doing that are on the front lines, reaching out to the poor, the fatherless, the widow, the hurting, the homeless, overcomers of those who are able to declare, "Therefore we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we're wasting away, yet inwardly we're being renewed day by day." 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16 to 18. And it goes on and says, "For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what's seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." God is desiring to do a new work within you. Can you see victory right now in the eternal? Can you see it? Can you see it for yourself? Maybe somebody told you we'll never amount to nothing in the past. You believe those lies. Why don't you start believing God's Word when it says you're made in the image of God? So don't give up, brothers and sisters. Hang on. Hang on. And trusting God knows that He means what He says when He tells you in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, where He says, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." Now I want you to realize something. Faith isn't faith until it's all you're holding on to. Do you realize that? Some people say, "I'm going to live by faith. But if things don't work out, I'll go back here and I'll do this and this and this." That's not really faith. Faith is when you don't have nothing else to do. You just got to trust God. And it's taking God at His Word here. Revelation chapter 21, verse 6 and 7. You pick up the Bible, you read the end of the book, and you'll see you're on the winning team. He says, now is what He tells you to be an overcomer. And this is what happens. He said, "It is done." Jesus comes on the scene, defeats the forces of Satan. He says, "I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To him, her who's thirsty, I will give to drink without cost from the spring of the water of life. He or she who overcomes will inherit all this, and I will be his God, and they will be my son." And he'll also say, "They'll be my daughter." He says, "I'm going to do this to you if you overcome." Then that's his promise to the overcomer. But to those who are overcome by sin, the devil, and the world system, Christ goes on and says, and this is Revelation 21, verse 8, "But the cowardly..." And notice here, the cowardly are put right in here with the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, and those who practice magic arts, idolaters, and all liars. The cowardly are right there. This isn't a time for us to be cowardly people, is it? No, we got to be bold. We got to know what God's Word has to say. We need to know who we are in Christ. He says the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters, and all liars, their place will be in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. Heaven forbid, right? We need to know who we are in Christ. We need to be bold in the Word of the Lord. We need to live in the light of God's Word. And I know that maybe sometimes in the past you've been cowardly, you've done some of this other stuff, really bad, terrible stuff. Well, the good news is, though we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And Satan walks around, and one of the ways he tries to devour those is he tries to tell you, "You're no good. You're too bad to experience this. You're evil." But no, that's the good news of Christianity. It's the grace of Jesus Christ. It's the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses us from all sin. We're a new creation. Isn't that good to know? This is the first day of the rest of our life. We can be overcomers, not as a result of our own efforts and righteousness, but by trusting in Jesus. And what's He told you? He says, "I've told you these things so that you, that in me you may have peace. In this world you're going to have trouble, but take heart. What did he say? I have overcome the world. John chapter 16, verse 33. He says, I've overcome the world. Thank you, Jesus. So now I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you right now to determine in your heart that no matter what you're going through right now, you're going to be an overcomer. You're going to be an overcomer. And you're going to remain faithful to God, trusting in him through the power of our resurrected Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Are you able to do that? We want to go to him right now in prayer. He's a mighty God, an awesome God, a great God. Oh, what an awesome God he is. What a great God. Thank you, Jesus. Can you just start right now, just thank him? Thank him. Thank him that you've got hope right now, that I can stand before you and tell you that you can overcome the evil one. If it had not been for the fact that Jesus rose from the dead, we couldn't offer you that kind of hope. Maybe offer you a word of encouragement or even a word of just pep talk, but couldn't offer you this deep, eternal hope that's available to all who turn to Christ right now. Jesus has conquered Satan. And because of that, you and I can overcome the evil one. Yes, he may know that his time is short and he's been thrown down here on earth and he's doing all kinds of crazy, stupid stuff. You and I can come to Jesus right now. How many of you want to come to the Lord right now? Just lift your hand right where you're at. Just lift your hand right where you're at and tell him, Lord, I want you. Please forgive me for my sins. Fill me, Lord, with the power of the Holy Spirit. I want to overcome the evil one. I want to live for you, Lord, both now and for all eternity. Thank you, Jesus, for your victory, and that now I can have victory. I give you glory, Lord. I give you honor, Lord. I give you praise. In Jesus' name, I rejoice. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing right now in my life. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. 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 What a mighty God we serve. What an awesome God we serve. What a great God we serve. This can be the first day of the rest of your life. Now, you don't have to go forth from here living like you've always lived before. You can live triumphantly. You can live victoriously. I want you to just get into God's Word and meditate on the Scriptures that I've shared with you, because I want you to know that greater is he who's in you than he that's in the world. We're serving an awesome God, a mighty God, a great God. And right now, I just want to say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the victory that we have available to us through our resurrected Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Help us, Lord, to live every day, every moment, every hour in the midst of that victory. We thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of New Life Evangelistic Center, along with the fatherless, widowed, and homeless in their midst, ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. In fact, if you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that at this time by just bowing your head and asking him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior. You can receive an audio cassette of today's message by sharing a gift of $3 or more with New Life Evangelistic Center for its work among the poor and homeless. Send your gift to New Life Evangelistic Center, P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, 63166. Be sure to include the program number and message title now on your screen. Now, may we all go forth, sharing the love of Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit with all of Mid-America.